Century as the world's first light railway. Tenterden was quite a sizeable town but had been missed in the railway mania of the 1840s, and the farmers in particular wanted a way of getting their crops and hops and milk to market, so they fought very vociferously for a railway. It never really made very much money at all. It paid a dividend once and started losing money in 1926. And so it struggled on until 1954 when it was closed. They did a survey just before the closure and they had 90 trains a week, and between them they carried 118 passengers. So there wasn't really much of an argument against it going in 1954. When the line was built, it was built very, very cheaply. And the cheapest way of building the line was just to follow the contours of the land. So if there was a hill, you went up it. Whereas the mainline railways used to carve cuttings and embankments to make it as flat as possible. So it was cheap to build, but it makes it quite difficult to operate. And that's part of the charm, is the little engines are working very hard. They really are earning their keep here. Whereas some of the preserve railways, the big mainline engines with tiny trains are a little bit like caged tigers.
Balance what power you've got against the load that you've got, and balance that against the conditions of the rail. If you apply
too much power, the wheels slip and you don't get anywhere, and it's sometimes very difficult to start. We've got a level crossing halfway up the bank, and sometimes we get stopped a bit if there's no one to operate the guns. To restart again can be very awkward sometimes, and it takes a little bit of turning the phone sometimes to get moving. But we always get it. People to run the railway on a day like today, and they're all here because they enjoy doing it and want to keep steam alive for future generations to enjoy. Comes to life in that, you know, in the morning you open up, unlock, put all the luggage out to give it a bit of the atmosphere and such like, and then the passengers start to come along. And every day is different. You never know quite what you're going to get, but you know, the engines are here, and it really does come to life once the engines arrive and the trains start running in and out. Generations that have been born since the demise of steam 30 years ago, there's still that interest. You know, you put a fire in the belly and they come to life and they've got a personality of their own. We get lots of very young children here and youngsters who are thoroughly enthralled by steam.
You've been on a steam train before at school. Yeah, I've been on a steam train before at school.
I am, yeah.
Jolly good. Yeah. Bye-bye then. Have a good journey. We've taken some big steps forward in the last few years to make sure that it is financially viable well into the future. The extra money that we generate from Bodiam, once that's open, will actually help secure the line into the next century.
Railways like the Kent, East Sussex and the Bluebell have now got a very powerful ally, a man who agrees it's time to get reconnected. Ed Burkhart is an American, but he runs Britain's rail freight franchise, as well as railways in America and New Zealand.
I think it's a great plus in this nation that many of the lines that were closed were saved. I'm going to make some predictions. Phones going to ring and they're going to be asked to haul freight on the network or passengers on the network. From a freight standpoint, we hope to have every line in Britain with a regular service hauling a wagon here and a wagon there to or from customers that are rail connected.
Certainly, Ed Burkhardt's thinking, if you read his thoughts, they're certainly very positive. He's called a complete new realism to attitudes. He's taken on board the fact that we're all in the same business.
Ed Burkhardt has brought railways back to profit on three continents. He's regarded as a business genius. So when Ed says little freight trains are coming back, people listen.